Good morning.
Hello.
So we will talk this morning about the search for life in extrasolar planets, mostly from the point of view of astronomy. So the focus will be on first on the planets, on how we can find this type of planets. I have a lot of slides, but I think at some point we will interrupt. We have an hour. I have been told that we have an hour, but perhaps it's even too much. There is a lot of information, so I will try to go quite slow. And please interrupt me just at any moment, okay? So, because there are so many arguments, so it's not just astronomy, it's also climatology, geology, formation of planets, origin of life. It's just too much stuff to put together. So, this desire to understand that if there is life or if there are other worlds outside the Earth is something very ancient in the history of the human thought. For instance, even in the Greek people, Democritus already, he was thinking, he had a rationalistic point of view of the nature. So trying to understand the nature, not in terms of God's creation, but in terms of nature, of physical laws, let's say, what we would call today physical laws, there was already this idea that there could exist other worlds outside the Earth, and even with people inhabited. And also the same was true for Lucrezio, which is a Roman poet. He was explicitly saying in his famous book about the nature of the things, that was thinking that there could be lives in other planets. And especially, particularly, if we skip to more modern time, Giordano Bruno, he wrote a book explicitly in the title that was about the existence of other worlds outside. But we had to wait until the birth of the modern physics to understand that planets outside, the sky, there are objects which are really like our objects, that they obey the same physical laws. And this revolution started with the observation, for instance, of the planets of the solar system with a telescope, with Galileo, and we started to prove that there are the other bodies outside the Earth in the sky which share the exact same physical laws that we have on Earth. And I'm sorry, we had a little fight between Steve Jobs and Bill Gates, but unfortunately Bill Gates was the winner, and so in the conversion of the files here, something is going wrong. This was bigger. And so the planets of the solar system were the only planets that we knew until 20 years ago, until 1995. And you know them here, are not, of course, they are not in the correct scale of distance from the Sun, but you can see some sort of regularity in the architecture, what we call the architecture of the solar system. We have small planets which are rocky, terrestrial type, close to the Sun, and giant planets which are rich of gas, more distant from the Sun. And these planets, this regular architecture and the fact that the only planet that we know that hosts life is among these rocky planets, puts several questions. Are there other planetary systems around other stars? Do they have this particular type of architecture with rocky planets close to the star, and maybe with one planet with life, giant planets outside? And are there any planets similar to the Earth? Or maybe even with life? These are the questions that started to come up, many years ago, but in particular 20 years ago, we started to detect for the first time planets not in the solar system, but outside the solar system, around other stars. And so why we had to wait so many years? Because it's extremely difficult to detect a planet in the vicinity of a star. we have two problems. One problem is the contrast of luminosity, which means that there is a factor of a billion or hundreds of millions in the luminosity of one star and the luminosity of the planet that is nearby, no? So this contrast is huge. It's like if you want to detect a firefly in front of a lighthouse, no? Or even much worse, probably, it's extremely difficult. But not only, the second difficulty is the fact that these two objects, when we look at them in the sky, they are extremely close. It's very, very difficult to separate them. So we must separate these objects, and in addition, they have a contrast of luminosity of a factor of 100 million or even a billion. So this tells you that it's extremely difficult to detect, to see directly a planet around a star. But it's not impossible. This is an example of what we called direct imaging, which means when you really see directly the planet in the plane of the sky. But this is very difficult, and this has been done for a relatively little number of planets. You must use special techniques, special astronomical techniques. One technique is called coronagraphy, which means that you obscure the light of the star, then you must have a very special high resolution in the image of the sky, you must apply a lot of special tricks, and at the end you can discover these planets only if they are very distant from the star, from their star, and if they are very intrinsically very bright. So they should be very giant, just formed with a lot of intrinsic luminosity and very distant from the star. So these are the only ones that we have been able to detect in this way. This is an example. So, because of the difficulty of this type of information, observation, the astronomers have thought of indirect ways of detecting these planets. And so the direct, indirect observational techniques are of several types. Unfortunately, here is not working a very nice little movie. No, it's not a movie, I mean, it's an animation. But I will try to show you from my laptop. But before, we must recall some concepts. So first of all, I think everybody, you know what is the Doppler effect. Do you know everybody who is that? Okay. So in the Doppler effect is when is applied, the original name of Doppler effect was applied to acoustic waves, okay? When we listen to an ambulance that is coming close, the frequency of the note will become higher. When the ambulance is going away, the frequency of the low note will go lower, okay? And this is the acoustic Doppler effect that was the first Doppler effect that was investigated. But then, the same effect applies also to electromagnetic waves, okay? Also to the light, it's the same thing. If you have a source of light that is coming closer, the frequency of the light will increase, and if it goes away, the frequency will go down. So, this is the first concept to understand. The second concept is that in astronomy we take a lot of information, not just watching an object, but studying the spectrum of the object. I think you know also what is a spectrum. A spectrum is when you take the light, for instance, of the sun. The most easy experiment that everybody knows is when you take a prism, for instance, you put the light of the sun, and you see all the different colors, no? And this is called the spectrum. Okay? Inside the spectrum of the stars, of the sun and of the stars, there are some thin lines. Okay? It's not just colors. These thin lines are very, very important because these are the foundations of astrophysics. Because from the analysis of these lines, we started, in, let's say, 1850, many years ago, we already started to take spectra of the star, we started to study the chemical composition of the stars, but also we could see how the stars, they move, how they move. because thanks to the Doppler effect, we can see, we can measure the velocity of the star along the line of sight, okay? Because we can measure very precisely nowadays the position of these lines in the spectra of the stars. And thanks to the Doppler effect, if the star is moving back and forth, we will see these lines moving in the spectrum. So the point is, we can measure very, very, very well movements of a star, even if the star is very distant from us. So let me try to see.
Of an astronomical object projected along the line of the sky. Okay? Yeah.
Okay, so what is going on here, if you can see, the planet and the star, they are orbiting together around their center of mass. Okay? So you know the law of gravitation is universal. We are the Earth is pulling us, but we are also pulling the Earth. The laws of physics are really universal and democratic, okay? So what the point is that, of course, we don't give a lot of pull to the Earth, but, and the planet does not give a lot of pull to the star, but it does. So and the laws tells us, the physical laws tells us that the planet and the star, they are orbiting together around the center of mass. Okay, so because of this, the star is orbiting around the center of mass of the planet and the star. So the star is wobbling, is oscillating back and forth. It's a very, very small movement, okay? But with astronomy, the spectrum of the star will shift back and forth due to the Doppler effect, and we can measure at any moment the velocity of the star, and we can see that indeed there is this movement. We can prove that this movement is due to the presence of a planet. So this is the most complicated to explain, no? You need a lot of information, Doppler method, spectra, and so on. But
with this method, you can measure at any moment at any moment
you can measure the velocity of the star and with time, and you can measure how the velocity of the star is changing with time. And this curve we call the radial velocity curve, and from these curves we can detect that there is a planet orbiting with a certain period. And this is the Michel Mayor, the Swiss astronomer, that in 1995 he made the first measure with his group. He made the first measurement of this type, and this started the era of exoplanets, which was exactly 20 years ago. Now it's 21, and this was the first planet. We put the name of the star, and then a small letter. Every new planet, we add a letter to the name of the star, and so this was 51 Pegasi B. The first planet, exoplanet, discovered in 1995 with this method. With this method, we can measure how the period, the orbital period, how much time takes the planet to go around the star, and we can measure, with some uncertainty, we can measure the mass, how heavy is the planet, okay? So, this is an indirect method that has been very successful. We have discovered hundreds and hundreds of planets with this method. I think there are almost 1,000 only with this method. There is another indirect method for detecting planets, which is much easier to understand. It's called the transit method. Also here we have another little animation. In this case, if the planet transits in front of the star, the light of the star will go slightly down, And we can detect the planet. In this case, this is extremely simply from to explain. The planet is transiting in front of the star. We are not, remember, we are not seeing the planet. We are measuring the light of the star, okay? And we see, we build what we call a light curve. In other words, we measure the light all the time. At some point, we see that the light is going down a bit and then it goes up again. Because when the planet transits in front of the star, then in that moment, there is no, the light goes down. Also, in this case, we can, this method has been now the most successful, the transit method, the most successful to find a very large number of planets. Now we have thousands of planets. And this is one satellite, one NASA satellite, which is called Kepler, that has discovered thousands of these planets. It's not an easy task because the probability that the planet passes exactly in front of the star is of the order 1/1,000. And so you need to observe many thousands of stars for a long time, waiting if there is a little change in the light of the star. And also in this case, you can measure the period, how much time takes the planet to go around the star. And in this case, you can measure the radius of the planet, okay? So, with the transit method, we can measure the radius. With the radial velocity method, or Doppler method, we can measure the mass. What happens if we combine both observational methods? We can measure at the same time the mass of the planet and the radius of the planet. And remember, we have not even seen the planet, okay? But in this way, we can measure the density because we know how much it weighs and how much what volume has the planet, no? Because we know the size. And for instance, we can measure how many grams per cubic centimeter, which is the density of the planet. You remember, for instance, the water has 1 gram per cubic centimeter, no? That's density one. And the Earth, if you do this calculation for the Earth, we have 5.5 grams per cubic centimeter, okay? So this gives an indication of what is a rocky planet, how it should be, which density should be. And instead, if you have a gas will have even less than water density, will have less than 1 gram per cubic centimeter. So what happens is that we have measured a lot of planets, and we started to measure also their densities. And so we start to distinguish between gaseous planets like Jupiter, let's say, with a low density, and rocky planets like the Earth with high density. And so we are starting to do some things. And as I told you, we have discovered thousands of planets, and mostly with these indirect methods. There are many other techniques also, which are very complicated. And they are very interesting, but the most successful are the two techniques that I just told you, the Doppler method and the transit. And we have discovered many new classes of planets that we didn't think that they could exist based on the solar system. And we have discovered a great diversity of planetary systems. Just I'll give you a couple of examples. This is an example of unexpected discovery. They are called hot Jupiters. It's you remember the solar system that I showed you before. You remember the giant planets. They are distant from the star. Okay, we have discovered these are actually the first planets that we have discovered. They are giants, but they are attached to the star. It's like here we had Jupiter, even closer than Mercury. Almost attached to the sun, rotating very, very fast in a few days or even hours around the sun. This is an object that we didn't imagine it could exist, okay? But they are very frequent. We find a lot of them, but because these are easier to find with these indirect techniques, because the indirect techniques, they are very efficient to find planets that are very close to the star and planets that are very giant, because they are easier to detect, understand? So it's not a surprise that we find a lot of these. We call them hot Jupiters, because they are so close to the stars that they are very hot, the temperature is very hot. These are objects that are not interesting for looking for life, for instance. But we have also discovered another class of objects that we didn't know before and do not exist in the solar system. They are called super Earths. Why do we call them super Earths? Because in the solar system, there is a big difference between the rocky planets and the next planet, which is Neptune, which has more than 15 times the mass of the Earth. There is a gap between the masses of the rocky planets and the masses of other planets. We don't know in the solar system any planet that has, let's say, 3 times, 5 times the mass of the Earth. We just don't know. And we have found many of these planets, and we have invented this name, super Earths. And these are easier to find than planets like the Earth, because they are slightly bigger. And these planets could have, for instance, conditions that are more closer to the conditions that we have on the Earth, and so maybe also capable of hosting life. And so these are some examples of the diversity that we have found, and the fact that the solar system is not typical. There are many different things in the universe, and with these techniques, by pushing a lot of these techniques at the limit of what we can do from the technological point of view, we can even find in the same star many planets. So we start to measure, to find the planetary systems, not just one planet, but many planets around one single star. And this is a gallery of planets, of system, planetary system, that have been found with that satellite that I have shown you before, the Kepler satellite. These are very new results, a few years ago. And we start to see, for each star, here are the systems, and the star is to the left, let's say. And you see that there are very diverse architectures. They are not all like the solar system. As I told you, the solar system has something very simple, with rocky planets close to the star, giants far away. Here is, we have a lot of differences. We start to see that there are many different types of planetary systems. So sometimes the Jupiters can be closer to the star, other ones are far away. And so these things start also to raise some questions. Why our planetary systems, the only one where we know that life exists, is done in a certain way? Maybe it's important, this type of architecture that we have could be important also for the existence of life, And these are the new things that are starting to be discussed. But of course, of all this big zoo of many new types of planets, we still now, if we focus on the interest for the possibility that life exists elsewhere, we are interested in trying to find planets similar to the Earth, okay? And for obvious reasons, because it's the only example that we know where life exists. And so what about these terrestrial planets? They are, as I told you, they are difficult to find because they are small. And with the indirect techniques, it's very difficult to find these planets. So here you can see how we have improved in the last 20 years our capability of finding smaller and smaller and smaller planets. This is 1995, this is nowadays, and in 1995 the first planets that we found, they were all of the mass of Jupiter, or even bigger, much bigger than Jupiter, but because they are easier to find, okay? With the years passing, we are improving our techniques for measuring these planets, and we are slowly starting to find planets of lower and lower mass. This is why you, in the newspapers, now, from now on, no? More and more often, you read that we have found a planet that's very similar to the Earth. We are getting really close. We have arrived to the limit that we are starting to find Earth. The Earth is about, one Jupiter is 300 times the mass of the Earth. So the Earth, the level of the Earth is more or less here. You see, we have just arrived very, very few years ago to the level of finding Earths. And the interesting thing that, as I told you, is very difficult to find these small planets like ours, but we start to have some little statistics, okay? We start to count them, and there is a very interesting thing that is coming out. Even if they are so difficult to find, if you make some statistical calculation, you see that they are very frequent. I mean, they are not frequent in the ones that we have measured because they are difficult, but if we correct for this difficulty, let's say, if you correct the statistics, taking into account how difficult they are to detect, it's coming out that small planets are actually very frequent. And this thing will be confirmed, we think it will be confirmed in the next years with the next instruments. We will start to measure many of these small planets, but we have already a very clear feeling that terrestrial planets are very frequent. So in many stars, even perhaps in stars that we have not detected planets because it's so difficult to make these detections, probably there are Earth-like planets. Earth-like, I mean in this case, just that the size is similar, okay? And they probably could be rocky. Okay? I'm not telling that they are like exactly like the Earth, because there are many other conditions, no? To make a planet like the Earth, so special for hosting life. So, do you have questions? Because now I will start to go to a second part, which is slightly more concerning habitability, life, and so on. So if you have more, let's say, astronomical questions, please tell me.
How do you separate planets from each other when you detect that by the Doppler technique?
Yeah.
Because there are more planets.
Exactly. It's very intricate. You see, you remember that curve, radial velocity curve that I showed you, no? Okay, you take all these data points and you subtract that, you make a fit, you make a curve.
Yeah, I understand.
You subtract that and then you are left with some noise, and maybe in that noise there is still another oscillation with another different period. And you make a further analysis and you discover another period and another curve. It's very complicated. But you
know
can
how
find
many planets are orbiting when you do this.
No, yes, of course, in any case, you are never sure that you have found all the planets in one system. You don't know. You don't know.
There might be smaller ones.
Yes, there might be smaller ones that you don't detect. But
okay.
It's actually really amazing, you know, how we can do this work.
Okay.
And I will tell you something else. To detect a planet like the Earth with this method, you know which position we must measure the radial velocity with a precision of 10 centimeters per second. We are talking that we are looking at a star that is distant thousands of light years from us, and we are able to measure a very tiny movement of only 10 centimeters per second. And we are able to do this and to find the planet. So this tells you how far we have gone as far as the technological improvements in the instrumentation. And in fact, one of the major impacts of these studies of extrasolar planets is that we are improving a lot of all of our technology for observing stars, basically, and we are improving a lot of our understanding of stars also.
Okay.
How much time do you have to observe a star to collect all the data?
Yeah, okay, this is also a very important question, and tells you again why it's so easy to observe planets that are very close to the star, but it's difficult to find planets outside. Okay, there is a law, the Kepler law, which tells you that if the planet is close to the star, okay, the period will be very short. If you go away, the period becomes long. For instance, the Earth takes 1 year, Jupiter takes 12 years, if I remember correctly. Many of these planets have been discovered because they take only a few days. So it's easy for us to answer to your question. If you are able to detect these very, very weak signals that I'm telling you, Doppler signals or transit signals, if you are able to detect the signals, in a few days you could discover a planet that is orbiting right in front around the stars. That's why we have discovered these hot Jupiters, because they are just around, they are very fast, very quick. No? Instead, if you want to discover, let's say, an Earth, you must, a planet at the same distance, Earth, Sun, let's say, you will need to wait at least 1 year to make just one period. But you know, with one period, you don't even trust that you have made a detection. You want to keep going on and show that there is a regular period. And in other words, to detect an Earth, this is another problem, no? One of the difficulties, you must wait years to detect planets like the Earth, and even more if you want to go to find planets that are even more distant. Okay, so, what time is it? Okay. So now we really should start to think that there are many, many Earths around, at least small terrestrial planets. And so, of course, we are really starting to ask ourselves, on serious grounds, we must start to ask ourselves, can these planets host life? Or is there life there? So there are two different questions. This is the planet is in principle has the correct conditions, physical conditions, chemical conditions to host life, okay? And this is what we call a habitable planet. This is potentially habitable. We are not saying that there is life, but we at least try to understand if there are proper conditions. And this instead, can we detect signatures of life with astronomical measurements? And so we will go through these two questions. The first one is the habitability, okay? But of course, defining the habitability or the capability of hosting life is a tough problem, because it is very difficult to define life itself, okay? It's a difficult task to define life. And so it's a very long subject. We start to go outside of astronomy, entering also in the field of biology, I will skip this. These are slides that I use in other talks, but the point is that there are some basic facts of life that are universal. If we want to have life, we must have a system that uses energy from the environment to work inside, and in particular inside the cell, which is the unit of living systems. You know, you must have a certain order, you must perform work, you need energy, and you must put in order, you must store information, for the information is essential to do all this work that is done. Okay, the information is stored in the DNA, you know, the DNA, and the laws of physics are telling you that if this happens, then there must be disorder that comes out. Could be in the form of infrared radiation, could be thermal light. You must emit something. This is an inescapable conclusion of some very basic principles of thermodynamics. You cannot to work and or create order without using energy and in general. So you must, there is, what I want to say here is that there are some laws that tells you that if there is life, then first of all, the environment should have proper conditions to host the system. And for instance, you must have energy, proper energy. But not only, this is telling you that life will influence the environment. This is not an imagination, this is physical laws, okay? And we can also go farther and think, what, looking at what is going on in the cells that we know. We have molecules that are moving, they are interacting, they are splitting, creating or creating new molecules. And for doing this, they need a liquid medium inside the cell, which is water in the case of the Earth. No? And also, you know, you need some pressure from outside. What I'm trying to tell you is that there are some, even if we don't know how would be life elsewhere, there are some requirements that come out from physical laws that can help us to tell how should be an environment, a planet that has life in it. And so, for instance, we know that we need energy sources in the planet. We need a planetary atmosphere for several reasons. The planetary atmosphere is also protecting the planet from radiation that comes from the universe. We as astronomers, we know very well that the universe is a very, very dangerous place for life. We have radiations, we have ultraviolet, we have X-rays, we have particles with a very high energy that would kill us if we stay outside of the atmosphere unless we are protected. This is called generically ionizing radiation. So we need, for instance, an atmosphere to protect life from that. So, you know, and so on, and there are other requirements. Like water, we want that water, the conditions on the planet must be suitable for liquid water. And I will show you also some examples. Where I will show you, and this is, well, water has very special properties. There is a long list of properties, I will not go. Now you see we are going to another field. We are not going in biology, we are going in chemistry. And the properties of water are due to the fact that the molecule of water is a, you can think of a molecule as an electric dipole, okay? I don't want to go in more details, but this gives a lot of properties of water, to water, like the fact that water is a good solvent where the molecules can split, they can go inside, they can recombine. It's a good medium to make chemical processes like the biochemical processes that take place in the life. So, and here I had another one picture, which is an animation, which is really nice. It's a simulation of what is doing water inside the, at the border of a cell. I don't know if you can see this, it's difficult to see from distance. The water, because of the polarity, because they are like little electric dipoles, they have special properties and they can organize the membranes of our cells in a spontaneous way. They can form a layer. And so you must think of these molecules that they are moving all the time, but they are keep, one of the many things that water is doing is also to keeping some structures like the border of the cell, of the biological cells. They are kept together by the fact that water is a polar molecule, okay? So sorry, it's not working. Water, as I told you, the list of properties of water is very long, okay? We don't have time, this will take another seminar. So, but we could also ask ourselves, but water is common? Is easy to find water in the universe? And so the starting point is that in principle it's not difficult, in principle, because you know, water is done by oxygen and hydrogen, and these two elements are very, very common in the universe. The hydrogen is the most common element in the universe. Oxygen is a quite abundant element in the universe. Here you see in a logarithmic scale the abundances of hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen. These are the first elements of the periodic table. And you can see that the oxygen is a very abundant element, and also hydrogen. So in principle, there are the ingredients for making water that you can find everywhere in the universe, okay? This does not mean that you have water immediately, because to make chemistry, to make molecules is difficult. You need some good condition, appropriate conditions. But in principle, you can have water. But you need liquid water, as you said before, because if you have inside the cell, if you freeze the molecule, the water molecules, the biological processes are killed, they are stopped. The life doesn't work, no? And so we want liquid water. And you know, from physics, now we go back to physics, to thermodynamics, and this tells us that to have liquid water, we need, as temperatures might be, must be in a certain interval. You can't have any temperature that will work. Also, the pressure must be in a certain interval. And so the temperature is very obvious. We know, everyone knows that below zero it freezes, above 100 Celsius we go to vapor. But this is obvious for us because we are living in an environment with one atmosphere, no? One pressure of one bar in the atmosphere. But you know, if for instance, if the pressure is much lower, these limits change, it can change completely. Also the pressure is very important. If the pressure is too low, you cannot have liquid water, no way, if the pressure is below a certain limit. So we are telling something very simple, that this idea that the planet must host, must have condition to have liquid water, is telling you that, okay, the temperature and the pressure must be in certain limits. And so these are our basic criteria, starting criteria, to say, try to understand if the planet is habitable or not habitable. Of course, the story is much longer, much more complicated, but at least if you look for this criterion of water, liquid water, we are starting to select planets which could be good or not. And in any case, only planets actually can have the proper temperatures and pressure to have liquid water. Of course, in the stars, the temperature are way, way too high to have liquid water. And in the interstellar medium, or interplanetary medium, especially in the interstellar medium between stars, the pressure is so low, is lower than any vacuum that we can make on Earth in our laboratories where we make the vacuum. We think we are making the vacuum, but it is more density than the interstellar medium. Okay? When that pressure is so low that liquid water simply cannot exist, okay? And so we are left with really few places in the universe where water can be in liquid phase. And these are the planets. Well, why? Because the planets, it's like we can tune them. We can put the planet close to the star, distant from the star, we can put it in the right position where it has the correct temperature. And if it has an atmosphere, we have a certain pressure, so we have a temperature and pressure that we need for the liquid water. And and these concepts are about the surface of the planet, okay? But you know, the story is even more complicated. We could have liquid water also underground. And for instance, there is one of the satellites that was discovered by Galileo Galilei, is called, around Jupiter, is called Europa. And Europa has ice on top, but below the ice, we think that there is an ocean of liquid water. So this is to tell you that finding water is quite complicated. We might find liquid water. We could find liquid water also in strange places. But now, in the next of the slides, I will forget about this thing of Europa and this type of underground water. And we talk again of the possibility that the surface of the planet has the proper conditions for liquid water. And this leads to the concept of the circumstellar habitable zone that you started for sure to read also in the newspapers. Habitable planets, habitable zone, these concepts that are coming out. These concepts are based on the possibility that the planet can host liquid water on its surface, okay? So, if the planet is too close to the star, the water will evaporate. If it's too distant, the water will be frozen. If it is the correct position in this green area, we call this area the habitable zone. But it's a concept which is not very well defined, because it depends on the planet, actually. It's not does not depend only on the distance from the star, because the distance from the star is very important, because it tells you how much light, how much is arriving on the planet, so which will be the temperature of the planet. But the planetary properties are very important. For instance, the atmosphere and the greenhouse effect. So now we are shifting to other type of science, the science of the climate. So you see, to answer to this question is if there is life, you need all the science, basically. And let's see, for instance, in the case of the solar system, here we are again in the solar system. This is the example of what we think is the habitable zone. You see, the Earth is inside, Venus is already too close to the Sun, Mars is a bit too distant from the Sun. This is debatable. We can discuss if, which is the exact definition, could be larger here or the other side, depends. But actually, if you want really good conditions, you must really be here. If you go a bit outside, the things could become very critical. So this is we are starting to tell something which is very important. Let's put together what I told you before. We start to believe that we have lots of planets of the size of the Earth in many other stars. Okay. So one could think, okay, so maybe there is a lot of life everywhere. Here we start to see that it's not so obvious, because, for instance, you need to have a very narrow interval of luminosity, of what we call insolation, which is how much light from the star is arriving to the planet. So, but anyway, going back to extrasolar planets, we started to detect some planets with the Kepler satellite. We have started to find some planets which, again, you are reading from time to time in the newspapers, oh, we have found a habitable planet like the Earth and so on. No? So, but there, you know, you need many conditions. And this is why we keep reading news that this one is better than the previous one and so on, because we, first of all, we want that the planet is really more or less similar to the Earth as far as the dimensions. You know, also the dimensions are very important, because if the planet is too big, if the planet will attract a lot of material when the planet is formed, it will become a giant. Okay? It's like a process that you cannot stop. It will become a giant, and in that case, we don't think that could be life in the type of planets. So, we want this condition, that they are really similar as far as the mass and the size. We want that the insulation is exactly the same. I told you before, if you change a bit of the insulation, I will show you some results of climate calculations. It's very dramatic how it changes. So now, and also we have different type of stars. We have cooler stars with a lower energy, I mean the lower luminosity, stars like the Sun, which are, we in astronomy we call G-type stars. which are slightly more luminous. Then, of course, there are even much more luminous stars and even fainter stars. And this is a gallery of planets that start to be more or less in the habitable zone, more or less have sizes similar to the Earth. The past summer, NASA made a lot of publicity about this one. You may have read in the newspapers. This is the planet which is most similar to the Earth as far as the dimension and also the type of star and also the distance from the star is, so far, is the best one. But in the next years, we will have more and more. And, okay, how much time? Because okay. Well, just, okay. So, how can we show you other problems to make a planet habitable? You don't need only the correct distance from the stars, but there are also problems. There could be problems with the climate, just changing other parameters. To do this, we are making now, even if I am an astronomer, in the last years, I have started to use some climate models to model planets like the Earth. And so, you see, we are more and more mixing to answer these big questions. We really need to mix the knowledge from very different sciences. And for instance, with these climate models, this is the temperature of the Earth at different seasons, at different latitudes, okay? And this is an example of a very simple model that we are running, which is a very fast model, just to have a basic idea. And this shows you how this model can more or less reproduce very fastly the data of the Earth. But okay, so now with this model, what we are doing is changing the parameters of the planet and see what happens. Is it still habitable? Does it still have good temperatures? And for instance, we have changed the insulation, the pressure of the atmosphere, the rotational velocity of the planet, how the tilt of the rotation axis, that you know is very important for the Earth because it gives us the seasons, or the location of the continents. If you put the continents in different locations, the climate can change, you know. So here is the insulation, how much light is arriving, how many watt per square meter are arriving from the star. If you change just for 10% less or 10% more the insulation that we're getting from the sun, we would get an Earth completely frozen Earth or completely hot Earth, not habitable, with very, very high temperatures. Just 10% difference in the insulation that we receive from the sun. So the insulation is the first thing, and this tells you that the distance from the star is very important, as I told you, the habitable zone. The surface pressure also is very important. And for instance here, this is half the atmospheric pressure that we have. This is four times the atmospheric pressure that we have on Earth, just not changing anything else, just change this. And you see here, you have much more extended poles with ices in the poles. Here, you start to have a very hot, hot planet. And so also the pressure is very important, but even changing the spinning, the velocity of the rotation, this is the tilt of the rotation axis. If there is no tilt of the rotation axis, you don't have any more seasons, no? The temperatures are almost the same all the year in a given latitude. If you start to tilt too much, you start to have strange things with it complicates the presence of life at a given latitude because you have very strong changes. And so on, there are, if you put the continent if you have only one big continent on the equator, you have this climate. If you have only one big continent in one pole, you have this other type of climate. So you see, it's very different and so on, and many other things I don't have time. But then, but with this type of models, we start to select In the future, what we plan to do is to select planets which are the best candidates. With this simple modeling, we will take planets that we are observing from the surface, and we will analyze them and say, okay, this is a good candidate. But what can else we do? Is there life? Can we do something to really detect life? Well, I will skip another part on the origin of life, it's too much, but okay, let's go back to the transit method that I told you before. In the transit method, the planet is going in front of the star. If the planet has an atmosphere, we can even measure the spectrum of this atmosphere. This is a very, very difficult thing to do. We have started, the astronomers have started to do this thing for the first time in 2007. So only a few years ago we have got the technique to measure the spectrum of an atmosphere of another planet. You can imagine how difficult this is, because I told you, just detecting the planet, as I told you, is very, very difficult. So we have something that we are not even seeing, that is transiting from the star. But when you study the spectrum of the star, you will find very, very small signs that are due to this atmosphere. Okay, so we have started a new era in 2007 of astronomy, the era of the study of the atmospheres of planets, very distant planets. And so with this in principle, at this moment we can measure the atmosphere, we can study these atmospheres only for giant planets, okay? Because we need a big atmosphere, big planet, to make this measurement. But in the future, we will be able, perhaps, to measure these atmospheres of super-Earth planets, and from many years from now, we will be able to measure the atmospheres of planets like the Earth. This will be very, very difficult, because it's something very thin to measure. But eventually, we will be able to do. And what do we hope to measure from the atmospheres? Well, in the atmosphere we can find water, for instance. We have already measured waters in the atmospheres of giant planets. But we can also find some, for instance, oxygen. So, why oxygen would be so important? Because if you look at the history of the Earth, in the first period, and now we go back, we go to another science, we go to geology, to measurement of the early Earth. We know that in the early Earth there was no oxygen in the atmosphere. The oxygen that we have in the atmosphere, which is a lot, is 20% of the atmosphere, and which is, we would not live without this oxygen. This oxygen is made by life. And it came out when life started to have photosynthetic bacteria. Okay? And this oxygen would not be maintained without life, because the oxygen is very reactive, is a very, from the chemical point of view, is very reactive. And it would, in the long time, would disappear, would react with rocks or whatever, and would disappear from the atmosphere. So this, if we find in the future signs of oxygen in an atmosphere, okay, that will be not a proof of life, but will be the best we can do for the next few decades. I stop here, so if you can have more questions.